You are listening to the Catholic Thinkers podcast, a free treasury of instruction in the Catholic intellectual tradition. If you enjoy this lecture, please visit us at catholicthinkers.org/donate.
This is Father James Schall, and I would like to do a short talk called Beatrice. This was published in the St. Austin Review in May of 2004. And it concerns Dante's Beatrice. 2 years before he died in 1945, Charles Williams, the English novelist, wrote a study of Dante called The Figure of Beatrice. It is simply a lovely book. This book is one I come back to every once in a while. When I do, I always stand amazed by it. It sits peacefully on my shelves, and each time I see it, even if I do not read it again, I know from the last reading that it contains the fundamental things. It is a book whose very existence is a reminder to ask oneself often, what is it all about, anyhow? The book begins by citing the Paradiso, Canto 23, Section 46, in Italian. And the Italian short phrase reads, Reguarda, cal sond io, end of the quote. And roughly, this means, look at what I am, or look. Look is a command, almost as if Dante did not himself get the point of the whole commedia of his whole journey. In context, Beatrice speaks quite forcefully. The Mark Musa version, which is the Penguin version, translates this passage as follows. Open your eyes. Look straight into my face, end of the quote. Looking into another's face, of course, is the essence of our longing, even for God, to see, as St. Paul said, face to face. Implicitly, in looking at what I am, is also the behold I am. Therefore, one who gazes at me did not create me. The days of Dante's life, presumably, would have been perfectly peaceful had he not, once on a street in Florence, actually seen a real Beatrice. Thus, in paradise, on encountering her, looking at her, she wants him to know that she is. Look at me. The young, Williams writes, are subject to a stupor or astonishment of the mind which falls on them at the awareness of great and wonderful things. It is not only the young who are so struck. Again, it is not merely being aware that great and wonderful things exist, but realizing that such wonderful things are at all, that they stand outside of nothingness, and we had nothing to do with their reality. And this awe is particularly true, as Dante understood, when what he sees is precisely a Beatrice. Williams thinks that this experience of being struck by a beautiful person is not rare, but rather ordinary, as if to remind us that ordinary people do reach the highest things even by living in normal streets in Florence. Nonetheless, the figure of Beatrice, that is, what we have in us caused by the reality of Beatrice, even if she is seen only once, begins to take on a further level of reality. Williams is careful not to make Beatrice simply a product of imagination. The subjective recollection within him, that is, within Dante, was of something objectively outside of him. It was an image of an exterior fact and not of an interior desire. Even though we have the power of desire, fact comes before it. Almost the whole battle with the modern epistemology is contained in this one observation. What is important is not that we know, nor is it our image of what we know, however useful that may be, our phantasm. No, what is important is that which we know. Our image of Beatrice is ours, but that what is important is not our image, but Beatrice herself. We are not Lockeans who know the image, but not Beatrice herself. The outer exterior was understood to be the image of things beyond itself. Williams recalls in a theological tradition that there are two ways to God. One is the via negativa, the way of rejection, and the other is the positive way, the via affirmativa. The via negativa realizes with Dionysius that God is beyond all of our concepts, all the realities we know. When we have granted all we can to what we know, to what it is that we affirm, still God is beyond the affirmation. We do not, in this life, see God face to face. To know God as he is, we would have to be God, or be made possible to us by God. This we are not, so we are not God. If we know God as he is, it is because he grants us the power to do so, even as we long to do so. The negative way was probably first. It was necessary first to establish the awful difference between God and the world before we could be permitted to see the awful likeness. Dante's way, however, is a positive way. The record of the Dantean way begins with three things: an experience, the environment of that experience, and the means of understanding and expressing that experience. Say, a woman, a city, an intellect, or an intellectual statement, or poetry. Say again, Beatrice, Florence, and Virgil. So the particular thing, the Beatrice, the Florence, and the Virgil, as opposed to woman, city, and intellect. Williams has a belief and a delicate discussion of the relation of such experience to marriage and the new depth to romance that revelation now makes possible. He is alert to the difference between Virgil and Dante by comparing what happened to Dido and what happened to Beatrice. Dido had been the enemy of Rome, and morality had carried her Hero away from Dido to Rome. But in Dante, they are reconciled. After Virgil, the intellect had had visions such as which it communicated to the heart, if indeed they are so far separate. Since Dante, the corrupt following of this way has spoiled the repute of the vision. But the vision has remained. People still fall in love and fall in love as Dante did. It is not unusual to find them doing so, the end of the quote. What are these visions that follow Virgil that the intellect communicates to the heart? This is the via affirmativa. This is revelation, the way to the ingodding of man, as it were. The word ingodding is made up as one word, I-N-G-O-D-D-I-N-G, by Williams. The ingodding of man, that is to say, the incarnation, the fact that God has created us and in some sense is present in all this. That the incarnation has made possible, then, the way of romantic love is a particular mode of this same progress, Williams adds. The general maxim of the whole way in Dante is attention. Look. Look well. At the beginning, he is compelled to look by the shock of the vision. Later, his attention is enforced by command, and he obeys by choice. And the beginning, two of the three images, poetry and the city, are habituated to him through, though still fresh and young. They do not astonish him, but Beatrice does. The via negativa, no less than the via affirmativa, both lead beyond themselves. Beatrice's command, riguardo, qual son io, is obeyed by choice. So the look at me, that I exist, this is obeyed now by choice, not just by accident in a certain sense. This voluntary mutability is the great mystery that Chesterton touched on in his essay In Defense of Rash Vows. The desire of all genuine lovers freely to bind themselves to one another. But Dante and Beatrice are not Tristan und Isolde. That is to say, they don't promise to die if their love isn't complete or to kill themselves. The via affirmativa does not lead to the lover's death or the denial of the world, but to the transcendent, even within what it is, to its realization that it participates in the love that moves the stars. In this very perfection, there is a longing, and this is the via affirmativa. The maxim of his, that is, Dante's study, Williams writes, as regards the final power, was this also is thou, neither is this thou. Such words recall Augustine on the beauty of beautiful things. Riguarda, quel son io, look at me, for I exist, in the short lecture.
We hope you enjoyed listening to Catholic Thinkers. Please visit us at catholicthinkers.org/donate to help us keep this content free.